of people who have HIV or AIDS. You can just yell them out.
Stigma.
Stigma, yeah. What are some stereotypes that we have as a society of people living with HIV? Like,
they're sick.
They're sick, they're weak.
They're gay.
They're gay, yeah. Anything else? I hear drug users a lot, I hear prostitutes a lot. I went to a high school earlier, and high schoolers have no chill. they were like, gross, disgusting, stay away from them. So this stigma still is really, really thick in our society. I've been living with HIV for over 7 years, and I'm gonna tell my story to you today. I'm gonna start with my ex-boyfriend. I started dating my best guy friend when I was 23 years old. He was my best friend for like a year and a half. He had helped me get out of an abusive relationship. And like I had friend-zoned him like super hard for a while. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I was like... so something changed and I started to see him differently. We started to date. We did everything together. We went hiking, we went to Venice Beach and looked at the art and the crazy people together. We went on hikes, we went on jogs, we did P90X in the living room. Does anybody know what P90X is?
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
High schoolers didn't know. I'm like, my age is showing. So, but yeah, so we, like, our relationship was based on friendship and it was based on health. Or healthy things and healthy communications. We talked about everything. This was like, so having come out of an abusive relationship, that was like the holy grail of relationships for me. I was like, this is the person I want to spend the rest of my life with. And about 2 months into being romantic, having sex, it was like a Tuesday afternoon, and we both worked in the restaurant industry, so like we had weird days off. It was like Tuesday or something. Like we were cuddling, and like he starts kissing my neck. And like, I started like, and like it's about to go down, right? So he goes, I don't have a condom. I'm like, well, you know, I was tested just 2 weeks before we started dating. I always got tested. I was lucky enough to have comprehensive sex ed in high school, so I knew what behaviors put me at risk. I always used protection, and even though I always used protection, I always got tested anyways. That was just who I was. So I knew that I was okay, and I asked him when he was tested last. He said, you know, oh, it's been a little while, but, you know, Brittany and Ashley are both tested, and they're both totally fine. And since I had been friends with him for so long, I knew both of those girls, and he made it seem like those were the last two girls that he had slept with. So I was like, all right, you know, I'm horny. I trusted him. I loved him. And so we stopped using protection. And after that first time, I kind of was like, well, if anything happened, like it happened, right? We stopped using protection, so we just continued not using protection. And about 6 months goes by, and I'm like, you know what? We probably shouldn't have done that. We probably should have gotten tested, gotten checked out first. So, you know, let's go to Planned Parenthood. Let's figure this out, and then we'll be on our way. So I took him to Planned Parenthood, and he got pulled into the back first, and then he came back out. And then 15 minutes later, they took him to the back again. And then he came back out with a piece of paper in his hands, and he said, I tested positive for HIV. And I was like, I was on my phone, like I had my legs like swung over the chair next to me, and I'm like looking at Words with Friends or something, like trying to figure out what to do with my cue. And he's like, I tested positive for HIV, and I'm like, yeah, okay. Like, we talked shit, like, that's all we did all the time. Like, we had that kind of relationship where we just joked around. And so I thought he was joking. And he didn't say anything, and he didn't sit down. So I looked up, and I saw that he had pieces of paper in his hands, and I grabbed them from him. And I was looking at information about HIV and AIDS. And I was looking at words, but the only thing going through my head were images of, like, the last 6 months of unprotected sex. Like, we were in love, like we had a honeymoon phase. So in my head, I'm like, there's no way that I don't have this. Like I have this. So I went up to the front and I asked to be buzzed in. And because I had like a room of people behind me in the waiting room. So I was like, I don't want to make a scene. So I let the door close behind me, and I like leaned over the front desk, and I'm like, you need to pull me in there as soon as possible. My boyfriend just tested positive for HIV. And she was like, okay. Like, I must have been really scary because the look on her face said so. About 15 more minutes goes by, and in those 15 minutes, I'm reading the piece of paper, and I remember them telling me that you could live a normal life, but that wasn't the message that had sunk in. To me, it's like you get HIV, it turns into AIDS, and then you die. And so I was looking at these pieces of paper, I'm trying to figure out when I'm gonna die. And it finally pulled me in the back, and in order to administer the quick Western blot test, they have to prick your finger and get enough blood. And I was so scared that like I had no blood in my fingers for them to get. They were like pricking, they pricked like three of my fingers 8 or 9 times, and they were like squeezing my fingers to get blood. It was like getting tested's not that hard, but in that moment it was hard. They finally got enough blood, they took blood from my arm as well. And they took us both to the back and told us we both tested positive for HIV. They gave us information about clinics in our area and sent us on our way. So I remember taking the elevator down and walking to our car. And I looked over at him and I'm like, where am I sleeping? Like, there was no question to me where I had gotten this from. I was like, how did this come into our lives? And he was like, no idea. And in that moment, it didn't matter. I knew that I had decided to stop using protection with this person without getting tested first. I knew that my sexual health is my personal responsibility, and I took that responsibility in that moment. And I was just like, I was happy to have someone with me to go through this together. I was glad that I wasn't alone. I was also thinking about it from his perspective. Like, not only is he getting this diagnosis, but he's also learning that he gave this to his, like, the woman he loves. And I know that he loved me. So I didn't want to make it any worse on him than it had to be. I drove us home and I parked. And it was October. And I'm from LA, so this is all in LA. And like, October's hot, right? So we're sitting in a hot car in silence after getting diagnosed with HIV. And I looked over at him in the passenger seat. He just looked scared. He was white and petrified. And in that moment, something changed within me, like a flip switch, or switch flip. And I looked at him and I'm like, no. Like, we're gonna beat this. We're gonna go in there, we're gonna figure this out. We're gonna figure out how to take care of ourselves. We're gonna figure out what this is, what this does, the medications, like diet, exercise. Like, we're gonna beat this. We are not gonna let this take over our lives. Like, I turned into Coach Kelly. I have no idea where Coach Kelly came from, but like, up until this point, I didn't have much to be proud of. I didn't apply to colleges. I didn't have any accomplishments to speak of. But this moment is my proudest moment, is how I responded to getting diagnosed with HIV. Because my first instinct was like, no, we're gonna fucking figure this shit out. And then like, it dawns on me, I'm like, look at Magic Johnson. He's cured, right? He's totally cured. Like, 1 year we're gonna be HIV negative. Just watch. 1 year we're gonna be HIV negative. So I go inside and I pull up my laptop and I type in, is Magic Johnson cured of HIV? And every website said no. Like, no, no, no. He's not cured of HIV. He takes medication just like the rest of us. And then it sunk in. It's like getting an F on a final. Like, shit. I'm like, I really have to deal with this. So we took the curtains off of our window so that we didn't have to wake up in darkness the next day. And then a month after diagnosis, we all worked at the Cheesecake Factory. I had gotten my boyfriend a job with me at the Cheesecake Factory. And one of our coworkers came up to me. He was like, hey, can I talk to you? I need to talk to you in the back. And he hadn't been able to look at me for like 2 weeks. And I had noticed that he was acting weird, and I was like, so he took me to the back and he's like, Kelly, I'm so sorry. And I'm like, what? What is he sorry? Like, I haven't told him. I told other coworkers, but I hadn't told him. Like, what is he sorry for? And he goes, Kelly, I'm so sorry. I have to tell you that I slept with my boyfriend. And I was like, no, you didn't. why would I tell you that I fucked your boyfriend? Like, who does that for funsies? I have nothing to gain here by telling you this. And I was just like, there's no way. Like, my boyfriend and I had an enthusiastic sex life. You know, even though I've always loved the LGBT community, I still had, like, the binary of, like, there's gay and there's straight, and that's it. So, like, the fact that my boyfriend and I had a great sex life meant that there's no way that he could be interested in men. So, this was, like, oh, holy shit. And I started screaming, crying. I was like a Disney princess. I was like throwing myself into the wall. He was like, Kelly, you need to calm down. People are gonna hear you. And I'm like on a shift, right? I wasn't on break. I was on a shift, I was serving tables. And he's telling me that he had sex with my boyfriend. If you're ever at a restaurant and you have a server who doesn't seem like they're having a good day, like, please remember this story. You never know what someone's doing. So he was into pills at the time. I forgot a detail. He went and got tested. He thought that he might have been the one who gave it to us. So he had gone and got tested, and it takes 2 weeks to get, like, the blood test back, so that's why he wasn't able to look at me in the eye. He tested negative. He didn't contract the virus. And he wasn't the one who gave it to us. So I'm like screaming, crying, and he hands me like a piece of an OxyContin to calm me down because I'm inconsolable, and I would have done anything to make that pain go away. And so I took the piece of the OxyContin, and I was like sedated for the rest of my shift. And I talk about this detail specifically because I want to point out the fact that I'm not a superhuman. You know, I've dealt with this really well, but I'm still a human being. Like, I don't condone taking OxyContin to calm myself down or to cope. But in that moment, like, I would have done anything. So I took the piece of pill, and I was, like, fucked up for the rest of the day, pretty much. I rode my bike home. I was working in Marina Del Rey and living in Venice, so I was really close. I biked home, and I confronted my boyfriend. I was like, hey, our coworker told me he had sex with you. Like, what's up? And he was like, no, that's not true. And I'm like, what? And he's like, no, well, like, are you going to believe him over me after all this trust that we've built? After everything we've been through together, you're going to believe him over me? And I'm like, this guy's lying straight to my face. And he did, for like 45 minutes, he was lying to me. And I was like on and off the phone with the other guy, like, hey, like, he's lying to me. Like, I don't know what to do. Like, how do I get this person to tell me the truth? The guy on the phone is like, Kelly, he's lying. Like, I don't know what to tell you. And I took a deep breath and I went back inside. And I was like, look, I'm already gone. If you want any hope of keeping me in your life, you're going to tell me the truth right now. And we had always talked about remaining friends after we broke up. And so I think that was like the moment where he was like, okay, I need to pass up. And he goes, yeah, I did it. And I had committed to Hanukkah that night with my family. So I was like, I gotta go. I hadn't told my mom yet. I had told my brother and my dad, but I hadn't told my mom. So if I didn't show up to Hanukkah, my mom would have asked questions. And I don't lie, like I can't lie, especially not to that woman. So I don't know if anybody has a Jewish mother, but so I showed up to Hanukkah. I'm like still fucked up on this OxyContin, right? And I show face for like 2 or 3 hours, and then the pill starts to wear off, and everything comes rushing back to me, and I'm crying, and I locked myself in my brother's room for like an hour while I calmed myself down. I finally calmed down. And I picked a fight to leave. I was like, how am I going to get out of here without telling her? And so I picked a fight, and I like stormed out. And I got back home, and he was laying in our bed. We lived together. And like I saw him laying in the bed, and I'm like, well, I'm not going to the couch. Like, the couch is a punishment, and like I'm not the one who deserves punishment here. So I got in bed, and he woke up, and he put his arm around me, and I was feeling really weak, and I was scared, and I let him hold me. And we ended up staying together for like 9 months. I was really scared that no one else was going to love me, and that no one was going to want to be with me, and I didn't have very much support at the time. I was fighting with my mom. My dad and my brother didn't know what to do for me, so I stayed with him. And over those 9 months, he and I had a lot of conversations about this. I asked him why he felt that he couldn't tell me that he was sleeping with men. And he told me that he didn't think that I would love him anymore. He didn't think that I would be attracted to him anymore. He didn't think that I'd want to be with him. And to me, that's a symptom of a deeper societal issue. Because I thought that I had created a space between us and an atmosphere where we could talk about anything. I thought we talked about everything. I thought that I knew everything about this person. And he still had this mind block that he couldn't tell me about this part of his sexuality. And to me, that's a huge issue. Like, we live in a society that tells us how we're supposed to act within our particular gender. Like women, like we're supposed to have like beautiful skin and like a perfect body and all these things. And men are supposed to be aggressive and assertive and unemotional. And has anybody heard the phrase toxic masculinity? It's a real thing, and it affects all of us in these ways. Like, I'm not the only woman who's going through this. I know a lot of women who have similar stories, and it's pretty well researched that internalized homophobia causes a higher risk behavior and more higher risk behavior, and then internalized stigma prevents people from getting tested. So like, these are like psychological phenomena that are very well studied. And it's like, I want to live in a world where people can be who they are and be authentic and be have integrity and do it with honesty and explore their sexuality, explore who they are, explore what they want, and not hurt others. That's the kind of world that I want to live in. So that's a huge reason why I tell my story. Like, using condoms and getting tested is really important. And like, that's like one moral of my story, but the other one is what I just said. So let's rewind back to diagnosis. So I got diagnosed, Coach Kelly came out. I realized that I have to live with this. And then, so I dove into research. I stayed true to Coach Kelly and I devoured as much information as I could get my hands on. I was learning like the science, the epidemiology, the history, the activism, the medication. Like, my whole thing was like, if I can figure out what's going on inside my body and exactly what this is, then I can take control of my situation. I started talking to other people who are living with HIV. I joined online forums. This is 3 months after diagnosis. This is a post on an online, it used to be AIDS Meds, now it's pause.com. You don't care, that's cool. So this is February 1st, this is 3 months after diagnosis. I posted, it says blessing in disguise in the subject. And it said, I read a lot of the threads in these forums, and so far I read a lot about the hardships of this disease. Frankly, I'm scared. Reading about the crazy medical bills, side effects of treatment, cost of treatment, stigma, etc. is very troubling. There must be people out there who have been living with HIV for years, and I've come to see HIV as a blessing in disguise. Anyone? And I got an onslaught of negativity. Like, there's a lot of people in these forums who are long-term survivors. Long-term survivors are folks who were diagnosed with HIV before medication came out. So these people have lost friends, they've lost houses, they've lost their livelihood, they've lost everything but their lives to this virus. So that was the reason why I got a lot of negativity, was because this virus has ravaged people's lives. And I realized how privileged I am to live in this place and in this time where I have access to medication. I take one pill a day every day. I can have a normal life. The pill renders my virus undetectable. I can't give it to my sexual partners, or anybody for that matter. Because medication is so good. And through talking to others, I developed an appreciation for being able to take one pill a day and to be okay. tend to go over, so I'm
6:25.
Okay, we're done at 6:45, right? Okay, I'll just keep going. Thanks. I'll just keep going. So, in response to all of the comments that I got, this is what I said. I said, wow, that's a lot of responses. I respect everyone's experiences, and I appreciate the time you took to respond. I'm choosing to look at this as a blessing in disguise, though. I don't know if I would have ever gotten the kick in the ass to look at my life the way HIV has forced me to look at it. I've had to completely rearrange my priorities and reevaluate every aspect of my life. Sure, I could have done this work to make myself a better person without having been diagnosed with this ridiculous virus, but would I have? I don't know. I'm choosing to look at this as what I need to go through to become the person I was meant to be. Character is built through surviving hardships, and you find out who you truly are in the face of adversity. I refuse to let this take my optimism and my spirit. I will thrive. I'm skipping down to the bottom. I don't know. I said, here's life according to Kelly. I was turning 24, so I thought I was smart. I realize all of y'all are younger than me. So, life according to Kelly. We are all going to die. Everyone is going to get some kind of disease at some point. Everyone has problems. This is my problem now, and who's to say that my situation is worse than anyone else's? And why am I going to let this get the best of me? I will find something to be thankful for every day of my life, even if it's simply that I have the fingers to type this response. I will fight for my happiness, and I will give more to this world than I can even imagine. I've had a very good life, and I know that my best days are yet to come. So, that's how I decided to approach this from the very beginning. And again, I didn't feel like I had much to be proud of, but I'm really fucking proud of how I dealt with this. I began looking for the blessing in disguise, and another way of healing was telling my friends. I would talk to my friends and tell my friends what I was going through. My friends would go get tested. It happened over and over again. People would hear what I'm going through, and it's like, we see HIV, but before I was diagnosed, I saw HIV as something that happens to them over there. And I think that's how we see a lot of things, until it's knocking on our door. And I feel like this is what I do for people. I bring it to people's doors, and I make it real. And that's what I was doing for my friends. And my friends would go get tested, and they would text me and be like, hey, Kelly, thank you so much for telling me what you were going through. I got tested, and I wouldn't have done that if you didn't tell me what you're dealing with. And so I was like, I need to be talking about this. Like, this is really powerful. This is really important. So I get my treatment at the LGBT Center in West Hollywood, and I made friends with the woman who does the insurance billing. Her name's Janesta. She's awesome. She called me one day, and she was like, hey, I did a CDC ad campaign with my son, and they're looking for more people. I think you'd be great at this. Are you interested? And I was like, yeah, absolutely. So I did that. This is me. It's on YouTube. I hate this video. I think I look so bad. So that's my best friend on the right. She's an actress, so she like carried the whole thing for me. Like, I was so lucky to have her with me, because like she was really good. Like, you'll watch it and she's like responding to like everything that I say. Like, so she's so after I did this, I decided that I was gonna say yes to everything. I'm like, I'm gonna become a yes woman. I'm gonna say yes to every opportunity that comes my way. I get an email that's like, hey, MTV's doing a documentary special. You should apply to this. I think you'd be great. I applied, I got in, I did that. It's called I'm Positive. It aired in 2012. And then after that aired, I got an email saying, hey, I was tasked with finding a young woman to come speak to at-risk youth with me. Are you interested in doing that? And I'm like, yeah, absolutely, I would love to. I just realized that. So this older gentleman, he's like in his 50s, he shows up in his little Volkswagen, and I hop in, and we start talking. It turns out he's a long-term survivor. And he's awesome, and we got along really well, and he happens to be the director of the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation. I had no idea that that's who was coming to pick me up. And we had dinner, and during dinner he's like, hey, have you ever thought about doing some public speaking about this? And I'm like, yeah, absolutely. I had a he like mentioned speaking, I'm like, yeah, fuck yeah. Like, I've been trying to do this for a while now. And so the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation brought me on as an ambassador, and now I represent them. Through them, I found the UCLA Sex Squad. The UCLA Sex Squad is one of their grantees. It's a group of undergrads who put together a theater production around the topics of sexual health. We perform at high schools around LAUSD. So I found them and I'm like, I want to do that. Like, I want in. So I started showing up. Actually, it was this gentleman here who brought me. He works at the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation too. He was on the sex squad, and he was the one who was like, you should come to a show. And I'm like, yeah, fuck yeah. So I came to a show. I started doing performances like as an adjunct. Like, I'd like pop up from the audience and like tell my story and then like sit back down. And then they asked me to join, and I started, it's an actual class with credits. So I took the class through UCLA Extension, and I got course credit that way. And one of the professors asked me, he's like, hey, have you ever thought about coming back to school and doing a master's? And I'm like, I don't even have my bachelor's yet. And he's like, well, what are you doing? You should apply. And I'm like, all right. I applied, I got in, I'm graduating in June. Woo! I would love to perform one of my spoken word pieces for you that I created for Sex Squad. It's my favorite one. Oh no, you're good. You're totally good. So I've been living with HIV for over 7 years, and you might think that the hardest part of this would be the health issues, but it's not. I'm actually healthier than I've ever been, virus and all. See, I'm not the one with the problem. He is. All right. So here's what happens. It's a cold January night, and I'm hanging out with this really cute guy. We're alone in his dorm again, and we're flirting real hard on the top bunk. See, we've hung out a few times before. The first time was in October. It was Halloween weekend, and we went frat party hopping on Fabra. We decided to break off from the group, and we got back to his dorm, and things got pretty hot and heavy pretty quickly. Like, we had a ton of chemistry. But I had to stop it kind of abruptly since I hadn't told him yet. So I got off, I took a deep breath, and I said, I'm so sorry, I can't go any farther with you without telling you first that I have HIV. And he was very uncomfortable doing anything else for the rest of the night. And to be honest, I totally got it. Like, at that point, I had had 6 years to process all of this. He was just a couple seconds in. So we just talked for the rest of the night. And it was actually really nice. We had a lot in common. Like, we had really good conversation. But that was then. This is now. I'm taking it back to January now. So it had been 2.5 months since that first time we hung out. He had ample time to research what I told him, that this virus is next to impossible to get from me, especially with us using protection and especially with me being on medication. But he was acting weird about even kissing me. I leaned in for a kiss, and he was like, and I was like, you okay? What's wrong? And he's like, oh, I don't really like making out. Even though we kissed like the entire time the first night that we hung out. But in the moment, I was like, whatever, I'm not trying to marry this guy. And he was still being flirtatious. So, you know, we're fooling around, a couple articles of clothing come off, and, like, I tease him a little bit. And I asked him how he's feeling about getting more physical, and he's shut down completely. He sat up with his back against the wall in fetal position, and he looks up at me with these big puppy dog eyes, and he goes, how do you do it? I'm like, what? He's like, how do you keep living? How do you keep going? And I'm like, ugh, I don't want your pity, I want your penis. I didn't say that, but I was thinking that. Stigma is insidious. It's the shade I catch with the way certain people ask me how I got it. It's that bitter taste in my mouth as I say the words, it's none of your business and it shouldn't fucking matter. Stigma is uncomfortable friction of abrupt penetration every time someone's afraid to go down on me. It's the thought in the back of my head when someone will be intimate like that, that maybe they're nervous or that they actually think I'm gross. Stigma is facing the word contagious every time I have to disclose to a potential partner. in this particular moment with this guy, it's the look of utter hopelessness and despair that I see written all over his face at the mere idea of living my life. It's the knot in my stomach because despite how annoyed I am right now, what I do is console him, make him feel better. I told him everything's gonna be okay and it's not as bad as everyone says it is. And I meant it, I really did. But why do I always have to make them feel better? Stigma is the shuffling of clothing as I race to cover my vulnerability. I don't feel safe anymore. I'm constantly fighting to live in a world that I think should exist. I use my diagnosis and my resilience as fuel to my fire, inspiration for my art, reasons to be confident. I'll be damned if I'm not sexy as hell. I get to be as seductive as I damn well please. I can have sex for fun if I want to, because I'm sexy. And I have at least 30 more years in my prime. I'm fucking worth it. I want to live in a world that isn't afraid of me because the truth is common sense, that this virus is not as contagious as everyone thinks it is. Not with how far medication has come. I'm not going to give this to you. I wanted him to give something else to me.
Mm-hmm. Kels. Keep recording or what's the tea? What's the tea? Ah, oh, god damn it. No. I'm not a surgeon, honey. My hands shake.
Three, two, one.
HIV if you are sexually active.
For reals? No, I'm just. Go ahead. Keep pushing.
What is the most common symptom of STIs and HIV?
It was so satisfying to see all the numbers go up. Oh, you enjoy it?
Yes. No symptom at all.
Wow, good job, bro. Wait, who said semen? Let's unpack this. No, I'm kidding. Ooh, one. All right,
which of these STIs cannot
exactly,
be cured?
Exactly, thank you. So hot.
Of the 2 million reported STI diagnoses in 2016, what percentage were ages 15 to 24?
A lot. For sure. It's all UC Santa Barbara's fault. I make like 25 problematics today. It's real bad.
I say our age group, but yeah, because I look like
adults. True.
What kind of lubricant should you stay away from when using latex condoms?
Aloe vera?
Things up.
Yeah, I know. I know a lot of people who use. Yeah, I know a lot of people who use. Yes.
If you want to use aloe vera though, make sure you get like pure aloe vera or organic. You don't want extra chemicals or additives. But aloe vera is.
What about aloe water?
Aloe water.
No, I'm just kidding. Keep going.
All right. Which of these activities is the highest risk for transmitting HIV and STIs?
I feel like it's definitely cool. The anus is V sensitive.
Yeah.
Ah, we knew it. It's the booty hole.
Unprotected vaginal sex is right underneath there. Unprotected oral sex is considered a low-risk activity. It's not a no-risk activity, it's low-risk.
Thank God.
And then mutual masturbation and stuff is... mutual masturbation is, like, all good. Yeah, and remember, there has to be an STI or, like, a pathogen present for there to be transmission. I think that's, like, common sense, but, like, I gotta say. What is the real life effectiveness of condoms in preventing pregnancy?
On the planet.
That fine print though. Maybe I can snag your
hand. With use, condoms are 99% effective, including human error, like breakage or putting it on wrong, or human error.
They should write that on the box.
It should be on the box.
Yeah, if used perfectly, it's 99%, but including human error, it's 85%.
Oh. That's amazing.